As you can see, I will talk about Southeastern Europe and more precisely Balkans and Ottoman Empire. And the topic is social networks and women's empowerment during the 19th century and the first two decades of the 20th. We could say until the interwar period. As you all know, women in Europe during the era of modernity found a way or ways of accessing public sphere. And a lot of them became significant figures, significant persons in the social, in the society, in many sectors of it, in education, in social welfare, in publishing, in political rights. And the question is, how did they manage to do this? Why, at the same time, the discourses, the gender discourses on the social roles of women were rendering them solely the private sphere as the royal domain, and were separating the private sphere, the private domain, from the public sphere. So this question we will try to answer, I will try to answer in this presentation, employing the social network theory. Having in mind the historical conditions that they define to a very great extent, at least according to my approach, individuals' activity, and also having in mind that those conditions, the historical conditions, are not stable, are not unchanged, I have chosen to present three cases here, three women or three women representative of three groups of women, so that to cover all this aforementioned period of 19th century and the beginning of 20th. But as the time is quite limited, I will focus to one only case, and I will make comparisons and references to the case that preceded and to the case that follows that one that I'm going to present. So, the area we refer to, as you can see, the Southeastern Europe, actually is identified with the Ottoman Empire. It's always. There are only two small states. Greece was only this place, and the Serbian place around there. So I mean, only two states, and there were some principalities, that means that they were semi-independent places, one here, two here, and by the end of 19th century, 22 years before the 19th century, there was also a semi-independent Bulgarian state. That means that in all this area, a lot of ethnicities lived, I mean all the Balkan ethnicities and many more, and there was a multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-religious place. I'm saying this in advance just to understand why I will talk about Greek people within the Ottoman Empire and Greek women. So, I will start presenting one Greek figure, Greek Ottoman woman, Sapfolonias, is this one. A very celebrated pedagogue and a very powerful woman at the public sphere, dominant figure at the sector of education, and more precisely, female education. Leonidas would be representative of a group of women, but they started being obvious in the public sphere between the times mid-19th century and 1870s. Such women are the other two, you can see Kayotia Hayana and Lascarillo. They were also very powerful. They had a lot of influence in the space and in education. But we So who was Leonidas? Leonidas was born in 1830s in Istanbul. She lived and worked throughout her life in this Ottoman area, as we say. She was from an intellectual and middle class origins. Her milieu was quite progressive because her father was a professor of ancient Greek, and he was connected to a circle of progressive enlighteners, Greek enlighteners, who worked in that place and influenced this area where Leonidas later will spend a big part of her life working there. And this is very important for the issue we discuss here. She was educated at home, but she took a very broad and deep education. She was educated in ancient Greek literature, in French philosophy and literature, German, and she spoke all these languages very fluently and wrote in those. This is also a very important figure for this woman because these exactly figures of her personality and of her work made her respected, being respected by the male intellectuals of her time. She started her activity before 1850s, at the beginning helping her father and being helped by him, and she was working in the eastern area. Most of the time, she started her independent career, we could say, after 1850s. And this career and this work was multi-layered, multifaceted, as we say. It included active involvement in education, a lot of writings, a lot of lectures, and a lot of publishing. You have an idea about those things. More specifically, she organized and ran a total of 8 schools for girls. Primary schools, high schools, teacher training colleges in the areas I saw, Izmir, Smyrna, Istanbul, and Samos. Those schools were either private, either communal, either funded by individuals and societies. She published 4 books, 2 original and 2 translated on pedagogy. She wrote school textbooks, 7, and also she published a lot of regulations for schools, the schools she organized, a lot of articles, more than 35. All this activity, I think that prefigures the dynamics of her influence on the education reality of the era. But in order to support such a stance, we should place this activity within the time it occurred with regard to the status of education and the course of its development. We talk about the number of schools, 8 schools. The 7 schools out of those 8 were run at the first period of women's education, a period when few schools were established in cities or smaller towns. That means that she had exerted one influence already from the beginning on the education, school system for girls. Also, out of those 7, as I said, 5 were in one municipality, Samos. That means that she organized the whole education of this principality because those 5 schools were for the total schools, the total number of schools working, that were established in that place. The second period of women's education in all these places, this period there was an explosion, let's say, of education, women's education. So a lot of primary schools, high schools, and in general, provision for every layer of the society was made, During this period, Claudius was running two of the most well-known high schools in all this area. One was placed in Istanbul and the other one was placed in Izmir. Those big high schools had a lot of schools inside them. Primary schools, secondary schools, teachers' training colleges, departments for teachers for gymnastics. There were, in general, big establishments with a big, very big number of students. Also another two figures about her activity. One is that her books had a lot of editions. The articles were published in journals that they were edited in Izmir, in Athens, in Istanbul, in Paris. And also some of her lectures were delivered at societies that they were run by men, and there were big societies in all these places. So, having this, those are the places she worked, and here we can see her movements in the States, and here we can see her influence, we could say, if we take in mind the circulation of her books and of her writing. So, we could say that it was a very dominant figure at all these places. And now we come to the question, how did she manage it? A very crucial role lies, according to my approach at least, upon the historical, particular historical conditions of the playing time. We're historians and playing. Place and time are very crucial in order to understand our issues. What does this mean for this case? A first such condition has to do with the very specific area in which Leon Diaz was active for most of her life. During the first two decades of the 19th century, the triangle of Eastern Aegean educational centers of Izmir, Kidonies, and Chios was turned into centers of diffusion of Enlightenment ideas and the modern approach to knowledge and teaching under the influence of a circle of progressive, well-known Greek Enlighteners who worked there. I mentioned them before. This circle, deeply influenced by the European Enlightenment principles, promoted by means of their writings and work, the Greek nation's revival via education, a project which involved straightforward women's education and activity. Thus, the educational culture of the place welcomed and supported Leon Diaz's activity. The second condition is more general. The right and is the right of the religious communities within the Ottoman Empire to regulate their cultural affairs and the specific form this right took within the Orthodox community. That means that during the period of the Great Reforms from 1839 to 1876, each ethnic religious community was legally recognized as an administrative unit, and was granted the right to run its own religious, cultural, and educational institutions with a self-defined administrative mechanism, as long as the Ottoman state of civil affairs was not challenged. Thus, the Orthodox Greek community organized its own educational system. This system was completely decentralized on the administrative base. Each individual town or community had its own internal administrative principles and its own separate educational sub-system. Exactly this condition, the creation of a completely decentralized system, provided opportunities to individuals interested, and women in our case, for setting up networks of power relations and self-empowerment, as it resulted in multiple centers of decision-making and education, increasing the possibility of access to them. Leonidas, for instance, seemed, based on all those things I said very briefly before, seemed to have privileged relations with community authorities in Cyprus, in Samos, in Izmir, and with individual agents influencing community authorities. The correspondence between her and these authorities proving, and her educational geography, the timing of the relocation, her moving from one city to another to the other, reflects it. For instance, she went to Samos after the invitation of the princess, that means the wife of the governor. Then she went to Izmir after the invitation of the owner of one school, and then back to Samos again on the invitation of the new governor. That means that she had a very broad network of good relations with established authorities. To implement her work, Leonidas moved within the central part of the Ottoman Empire, as we said, Istanbul, Asia Minor, and Aegean Islands. She worked in cities and parts, and this is important because she worked in cities and parts of the empire which provided the general educational and cultural models for the rest of the Ottoman territory. Istanbul was the capital and the educational and cultural center of the Ottoman Empire. Izmir, the most European and wealthiest city of the empire, the second largest port of, as regards economy activity, and the third most populous city. Samos, a principality with direct and almost exclusive cultural and economic relations with Istanbul and Central Europe. It is known historically that most cities and towns in this great area were shocking teachers that had been graduated from schools from those central cities, Istanbul and Izmir. That means that the graduates of those schools were spread all over the place, and the head teachers kept on having a lot of relations with those ex-students of theirs and female teachers. That means that another network supportive to them was built in this way. Because Leonidas working in these great schools, students were asked for being teachers in different places. She kept on having correspondence with them, and we can see that she had a lot of invitations of towns where her students were there. Another factor, or another kind of network, is family supportive network. We have already talked about her father, who worked with her at the first steps of her activity. But also her father seems to be behind all those, or most of those, invitations. When her father was working in Samos, because he was there at that time, he heard, he was informed, that the princess was going to build one school or to establish one school. So she wrote there, and he proposed her daughter. And then the princess wrote an invitation to Leonidas. This is one aspect of the family network. Also, the husband of her sister, a very powerful merchant and very wealthy merchant, he's supporting her publications with being sponsored economically for them. And her sister also is one woman that is publishing published, okay, was one woman that had published one journal, women's journal, in the pages of which were most of the activities of Leonidas. And talking about this journal, we are coming to another kind of network which arose in the last quarter of the 19th century, and is this of press media network. Leonidas developed very good relations with a network of press media which promoted her work, communicated and reported all her activities. This network included, in addition to her sister's journal, the newspaper Amalthea, the biggest in numbers and circulation newspaper in Izmir, the ladies' journal, the feminist journal of Kaliroi Paren in Athens, to mention only few of the journals that very frequently mention Leonidas. And last is another kind of network, personal network with influential individuals. People that they had socially power and they were acquaintance of her. For instance, the wife of the Sultan's dog. It was a woman that was in her circle as well. So, we can see this kind of multiple networks that Leonidas and women of her time are basing around their power. In comparison to women of the end, the women that they were before, to the end of 18th century and beginning of 19th, women of Leonidas generation have proceeded much. This first group of women before Leonidas were women from aristocracy, and they were the first that they became obvious in the public sphere just by their writings. If we see the introductions of the books of those women, we can find out that the only network for them to support them, it was their strong and powerful family network. We can see that most of their women write about their husbands, their brothers, or their fathers who gave them the books or encouraged them to write or to publish. That's why after this time of their youth, because they were young when they were publishing, we cannot find another sign of presence in the social sphere. That means that this network was supporting them, but besides defining them, bordering them. After Leonidas, and I'm finishing with that, after Leonidas, from 1875 onwards, emerged another group of women with new social and historical conditions, another generation of women who grounded their empowerment in a different kind of media, or their networks had differences from this generation. This figure there is Kaliroi Paren, the first feminist in Athens. Most of these women, as you can see, the social networks are there, most of these women have studied in high schools and a lot in boarding high schools. So the relations and friendships created during their studies developed their first network of communication and support. Some of them worked later together in the same schools or edited journals together, as we can have a lot of examples about this. This last quarter of the 19th century and the first decades of the 20th shows a growth of women's publishing and periodicals. Around these periodicals, new networks were established. So we talk about the network of Kaliroi Paren, or network of the Journal of Ladies, the network of the Journal Igoyenia. So this network of women around the journal is a new kind of support at this period. And the journals themselves also, they establish the point, they constitute a network, because even the readership works in a way supporting the women publishing the journal. Last kind of new network, social network this period, are the associations, women's associations, and mostly feminist associations. So I don't have time, so I conclude. Concluded, we would say, so concluded, we would say that the particular historical conditions define to a great extent the means for presence in public sphere and provided different opportunities for the empowerment of women. At the first period of women's presence at public sphere, family network was the only means for women's support and access to public sphere. And this refers to women from the very upper society, the part of the society that did not have another kind of activity in the public sphere. At the second period, mid-19th century up to 1870s, women originated from the so-called middle classes, most of them being educated at home, having worked within favorable conditions for the women, due to the need of the societies at this part of the European world for westernization, set up multiple and partly overlapped networks, which were based mostly on their family and personal connections. Significant feature of them was that they sought to existing networks of power and they included individuals of both sexes. At the third period, women's networks became more female. Their greatest power lied on their own gender. They participated in family journal cycles, female associations and feminist groups, national and international. The latter has to do with the emergence of the movement of feminism internationally, which turns to women for empowerment, leaving behind the claims to society and main powers for actualization of their demands. Thank you.